it's times like these you give and give again. It's times like these you learn to love again. It's times like these, time and time again.
Hail, hail, everybody. Welcome to the next, latest, and greatest Smell the Glove. I'm here with Rev. Rev, how you doing?
Hail, hail. How are you?
I'm wonderful. Is it? It sounds. How's that sound? That sound good?
I'm hearing a little pop and a whistle. I don't know what's going on. No, it sounds good.
It does. Did someone turn off that fucking vacuum or that hair dryer or whatever the hell it was, right? Oh man. Anyway, so Rev, we want to start out with Chris is going to join us, but he's got a little issue right now with getting his house in order as Hurricane Irma shows up somewhere near where he is. Hopefully west and west and west of him. Thank God it's not coming to Myrtle Beach. Thank God. But it does look like Glasgow outside today. It's gray as shit. It looks, I mean, all I need is some, you know, big stone buildings and I'd feel like I was in Glasgow. But anyway, Chris, so we're praying for you. Everything will be fine. I think, the downside is going to be a little bit of wind by him and some down branches and stuff. So I hope everything works out. So, and then for Paul, he's that, what, no one knows his name, fucking Scottish cunt guy, right? That's what they call him. Anyway, so we'll do Paul, we miss you too. And Rev, you don't say anything apparently.
I don't say anything?
That's the skit. Apparently you don't say anything. You're just there.
I just gotta gab more.
We'll get into what that means later. We will get into that later. Anyway. So, Rev, before we get to Hamilton, PSG, and everything else, let's start out with something else. Let's start out with what you've been waiting for and waiting for. Patty finally signed. We haven't talked to you since Patty signed. How did you celebrate Patty Roberts signing back for Celtic?
What did I do? I just, you know, I don't want to say it was like anticlimactic or anything, but I guess the day when they finally fucking said it, I was just like, it was just like a sigh of relief, you know, just like a fucking yeah, because finally just they said his name, you know, that video that they put out, you know, the long thing of, you know, going through the training room or the whatever. With all the jerseys up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Standing next to Brian's jersey and stuff. And then you saw that, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Do you remember the picture earlier in the day? Is this real or is it fake?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
The still picture of him at the last scene of him standing there in the locker room?
Right. But, yeah, and then but I'm just like, thank God. It's like, all right, game on. We fucking got this. And of course, like, I just want to take a quick peek at the superstore just to see it. And I'm just like, nope, still no away jerseys. Still don't even have them.
No way. That's what you're waiting for, the away jersey.
Yeah.
That's what you need.
Dude, like, everything's out. Like, I'm just taking a peek. Like, I can't get one right now anyway. But I'm just taking a peek just to see, like, dude, everything's out of stock.
Yeah, that's a good thing, right?
Just started.
And in the long, in the long term, it's a good thing. But this is something that was interesting about the jersey stuff. The away jersey, I mean the home jersey that I got when I was in Glasgow for the cup final. So I bought one, and I remember last year's were relatively narrow cut. The jersey is huge. I mean, it's like a size bigger. Not the real one, but the replica. And I found the presentation jacket, the walkout jacket, the green one with the gold. And that came in and that's cut small. I can't figure that shit out. I mean, it's going to get to the point where I might as well just wait till I get there to try stuff on because because it's going to cost me the same amount to ship it back. By the time I ship it back and get it back and everything else, it took like 8 days, you know, to get it in the first place.
If this shit wasn't so expensive, I would rather just like buy two.
Yeah.
And just eat whatever the shipping cost is back and just be like, okay, you know, I'd rather, you know, have that way. I know I'm going to keep one, but it's like, yeah, you know, but you're spending like $200-$250, whatever, just to,
yeah,
to know like, yeah, whichever one. But,
so anyway, so there's no patty stuff. We got a little tangent there.
Yeah. So the home sponsorless jersey is out until the middle of October. Home with the sponsor, I think mediums, large, and extra large are out of stock, and the away jerseys are completely out. Something like that. Like, it's like, yeah, it's good. Like, everyone, I guess, over the summer went crazy and bought stuff. Hopefully people, if they did jump the gun and they got, you know, Patty jerseys, they got 7 instead of 27. Like, I hate to be that guy walking around with a, you know, Patty 27.
Oh, on the new one.
The dark green.
Oh, yeah, on the new one. Oh, I see what you're saying, yeah. Yep.
It shows a good thing that, you know, that they're already sold out the new stock. That presentation jersey, that looks nice. That still is in stock, at least in my size, or what I think would be my size. So I'm just
whatever it is, it's small.
Cross my fingers.
Either that or I gained 70 pounds between the time I ordered it and the time I put it on.
It's still kicking me. I mean, yeah, we're going off track, but like the 125th presentation jacket with the tricolor.
Yeah, I wish I had mine.
I got one of those. And I got a large. So I'm like, all right, it's Nike, and all the Nike stuff, they fit, you know, the jerseys and stuff, they fit perfect. And I got a large, and for some reason, that was really small.
Yeah.
And, like, it just was, like, the sleeves are, like, just a little small. If I don't move, it fits me fine. As soon as I start to move, it sucks.
Yeah, if I just put mine on and don't zip it up, I look okay. If not, I look like I'm in a wet T-shirt contest.
Yeah,
that's how small the fucking jacket is.
But like, I have a standing like eBay search that anytime anything comes up with like Celtic FC, Celtic jacket. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this has been going on since. Yeah.
Yeah, I have not, I have never seen one on eBay.
Once, like six months ago, it popped up as a Celtic sweatshirt, but it was like an adult small. I'm like, that's not even. So I need like an XL.
Exactly. Exactly. Anyway, did you smoke a cigar? Did you have some pizza? What did you do when you finally saw it?
You know, I did like a little dance. I cracked a bottle of, I forget what I had, something in the fridge.
Little Bucky Arbaugh.
You know, put on the revs. So I'm just, you know, changed everything to pinch all the lyrics to Patty.
That's great stuff, man. That's awesome.
Went into Photoshop and, you know, Photoshopped KT's face out of everything.
Did you do that to your wedding photo? Like, took Amy's face off, put Patty's on?
I should. You know what? That's a good idea.
that is commitment and love right there. That's serious. Did you now? I want to talk about him just for a few seconds. There's two things that came up, and the two things I want to ask you about. The first one is is about Brendan and what he said, and I want to ask if you believe him. A. And B, do you believe the number? So do you believe that Brendan really, really tried to buy Patty Roberts?
Yeah.
That's just yes.
Yeah.
You believe him? Yeah, okay. You know these lines. Okay. Now, do you believe that they were willing to offer $30 million for him?
No, I think that number was just the we could have given them this much and they would have said no. I don't think they really went that high, but that was just like the, you know, like the, yeah, like I don't want to say like the over exaggeration, but I think that was just the analogy, I guess, that he was trying to use, that, you know, they just kept making offers and no matter what, they were turning everything down, that they want to keep him. And that that was just the example that he was using, that, you know, no one regards him as a 30 million pound player, and that they could have basically doubled what everyone thinks he's worth, and they still would have turned it down, that no matter what, they want to keep him, apparently.
Right. Now, do you believe – how can I put this? Do you believe – I mean, well, not do you believe – Does that conversation change the optic of, for fuck's sake, another loan?
What do you mean?
Well, does it change the way you look at it? Does that make sense?
The conversation itself,
because you know what I'm talking about. Like, when he signed a loan, it's like everyone and their sister on Facebook complaining. I got the goddamn fucking money. How come I'm not paying any fucking players? Blah 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 blah.
Right.
I mean, so that's the see. That's the reason why I asked the question. I mean, does that mean anything? I mean, it's just weird because. It's that. Do you think the like? Here's the reason why I asked the question. Do you believe Brendan? Do you believe him because they actually tried to buy him, or is it something that Brendan basically said because they're trying to cover their ass in the optic and they really don't want to buy him? I mean that comment of 30 million. That's an odd comment to make. To me, it is because I look at it and I go, wow, 30 million. Okay, was it just a throwaway comment or was it just something to shut people up? I mean, that's. It's just weird. I look at it and I'm like, I really can't tell what he meant by that. Is it an interesting comment? Yes. Do I believe him? I mean, I think it kind of went like this. Hey, City, can we have Patty? No. Okay, cool. Yeah, we tried to buy him. I think
I mean, the fact that it took so long, I think, I genuinely believe that they tried to get him, you know, with, I don't want to say with absolute haste, but with some more than usual Celtic effort. And you know what I mean by that, like the typical waiting until the last day and, you know, really dragging their feet on players, you know, there's no reason to have to wait.
Yeah, Rev, but here's the thing. Do you think it was Celtic dragging their feet this time, or do you think it was City sitting back going, I don't want to face him, and I want to make sure they're playing in the Champions League, and blah, blah. I mean, do you think there was a checklist of things that had to happen first before they said, okay, fine, you can go?
I would say it's probably, you know, definitely more on City's end for sure. That's what I mean. Like, I don't think Celtic was every day rapping at their door or, you know, just sending emails or doing whatever. I mean, I forget whenever it was when, you know, Wawa was there and it, you know, in Manchester. And it was still how many days after that he was announced. It was still like another, what, like 3, 4, 5 days, if not.
Yeah, that was with a
that was with a
5-0 lead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it still wasn't until like, yeah, Tuesday or Wednesday.
Yeah, afterwards.
So I think that, yeah, it was, they're still like, even that alone, and that was already the end of August. So I think that alone, you know, shows like they were making some efforts. And whatever the case it was, that it was on City's end, that, you know, whether it was, yeah, they wanted to not have to play us again.
Right.
Or, you know, whatever, you know, they're holding out for anyone else. Who the fuck knows?
Right. waiting to see if, like, Johnny Hayes is actually any good.
Like, I don't, and that's what I get. Like, let's go under the assumption that you know, they he's not in their plans, at least, you know, right now,
right.
whatever. Under the assumption that we are, you know, making, you know, a decent effort, you know, to buy him for a fair amount of money. So it's like, why wouldn't they? You know, he never played for them, you know, in any earnest capacity. So they're basically getting, you know, some money for free. Yeah, I think, you know, Fulham gets a chunk of the change. So that's fair that they want to, you know, make some bit of profit. But, I mean...
Do you believe that? Do you believe... I think that's just paper talk. I don't think anyone from Fulham called City and said, "Sorry, don't sell Paddy because we want our percentage."
Oh no, I don't mean like that. I would say that City would want more money to cover for what Fulham would have to get.
Right.
That's all.
I don't think they give a shit. In the same way, I don't think Southampton really gave a shit whether or not they sold Van Dijk to give us our, you know, 10 or 15 or 20 or 80% or the hell it is. 5%, right. 2%. I couldn't imagine someone from something calling Southampton going, excuse me, why haven't you sold Van Dijk yet? Or hold out for another 80 million for Van Dijk.
I remember reading an article that was towards the end of the transfer window and saying that it was kind of lambasting Chelsea and City for the number of players that they let go or sold or whatever in the transfer window.
Mm-hmm.
And there was something like City let like something like 28 players go either between, you know, proper transfers or loans or whatever. And it's like you have that many players in your system, first team, reserves, you know, whatever. And it's like, he's the nothing, really. Why are you focusing so much, or seemingly focusing so much, on this one player who's, you know, let's just say 12 million pounds.
Right.
That's what they got, you know, that's what they paid for him. Let's just say that 12 million pounds, that's fucking nothing to you.
Right.
You just bought, you know, City, whatever group, you know, the umbrella organization just bought another team in Spain. So now that's like four teams that they have. You know, New York, Melbourne, Spain, and Manchester. You just bought another team. What's 12 million pounds to you? Obviously, you know, I'm
nothing.
Looking at through...
it's nothing.
Through, you know, Yeah. I'm looking at through the...
considering what they spend their money on.
Glasses, but it's like, yeah, that's nothing to you, so just let it go. I don't know.
Unless they believe he's worth it, and, you know.
Well, now cut to, you know, last Friday.
Right.
And my first thought is, okay, Paddy's playing. Is he, you know... On one hand, I'm thinking, okay, he shouldn't have a bad game because he's playing with people he just played with all last season, so he should be able to slot right in, no problem. But he hasn't really played all summer, so he might be, you know, a little slow and all that shit. But at least chemistry-wise, there shouldn't be an issue. And then, boom, he's fucking man of the match, getting assists, making, you know, runs and cuts that are... He doesn't look like he was away at all. And it's like, oh shit, they're gonna not... They're gonna want him back in January because, you know, he's far exceeding expectations and shit.
Now that you say you say that, I have a question for you. Gordon Parks, who writes for the Daily Record, who I'd seen a couple things, he had made the comment that he felt that Paddy had shown no ambition by returning back to Celtic, and that he should go somewhere else where there is a lot more. He actually was interviewed with Keith Jackson. There's like they do their weekly video, and he said he should go somewhere where there's some adversity because everything's too easy for him at Celtic. expound on that for a few minutes because I have a couple things I want to say, and I want to give you. since you never say anything on this show, apparently, I'm going to let you go ahead and talk about that for a minute. When you saw that, what was the first comment or thought process that came out of your head besides what a fucking idiot this guy is? I had to be the first one. What was the second thing?
I mean, what do you want? Like, okay, the only thing I would say is last
what
year.
What does he want? I don't know. I know what he wants. He doesn't want him here because he's afraid Rangers are going to get their ass kicked because he's playing.
Oh, yeah. You know, last year, admittedly, and Brendan Rodgers, I think, eventually kind of came out and said it at one point in a post game because, you know, he was favoring James Forrest. And he said, like, you know, we're going to play our players versus lone players because that's who are going to be around and stuff. But especially, I think, in Champions League games, Patty's just got the better natural talent, footwork, yada, 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 mm-hmm. against, you know, the better European competition, mm-hmm. et cetera, et cetera. So, like, what more challenging opposition would this guy want? Like, where else is he going to go? You know, is Nice in, you know, European competition? Right. I don't know. I forget who else was looking at him or wanted to get him. But, I mean, he wasn't, again, you know, going back to what it seemed like, everything, he wasn't not interested in coming here. It looks like all summer he wanted to come here. This is where he said he was happy playing, comfortable playing. I think long-term, like, he wants to play, assumingly, at City, or at least in England somewhere.
Right.
I mean, that's where he's from, you know, so, like, you know, don't blame him. Mm-hmm. But he said, you know, he loves the fans, he loves the reception he gets here. So, at least for right now, yeah, he's happy playing here.
Right.
And he gets
but do you think he showed in, do you, like, to what Park said, what do you think, what was your... When you read what Park said, what did you think?
You know, it's just bullshit to create, you know, get some column interest, column inches, and sell some newspapers. That's it.
What's funny is, I don't know if you saw the video, like they actually have, they do their weekly, you know, conversation on video mm-hmm. in the newsroom. And, it's pretty, I mean, Keith Jackson basically made fun of him the entire time and said, "No, you're wrong. But I'll let you go ahead and say something different later if you're wrong. I mean, if you're right and we're wrong, but that's fine." But here's the thing: let me tell you why I think the whole the whole conversation about the league is weak that way the players don't improve. Why that's bullshit. And Gordon Parks, as a hurting Hun that he is right now at this point in time, should really understand this. What I get out of players improving, okay, all I got to do is measure, okay, and the measurement is truly the difference between 2 years ago this year, 2 years ago last year, and this year. Now, if you look at the players that Ronnie brought in, and Ronnie brought some players in, and sometimes he was in charge of that, sometimes he wasn't, depending on who you ask. We ended up with, you know, 85 midfielders, no wingers, and tried to play players out of position. All that stuff that he did, fine. He leaves, and if you look at the 2 years that Ronnie was there trying to go ahead and qualify, it didn't happen, okay? And the team in and of itself really didn't improve as players themselves, either being he didn't bring the right people in or he didn't actually improve the players, whatever. In comes Brendan. He changes everything. Every one of the players say that everything is different compared to what they did before. The players are in better shape. Players are this, players are that. All these things they did. Everything's different. Excuse me. Sorry about that. Now, here's what we've got. Now we've got another year down the road. And I think everyone would agree that qualification was a little bit easier this time compared to last year. Wouldn't you agree, Rev? Like qualification rounds minus the, you know, the nil-nil at home and then the 1-0 away, you know, that was
the actual competition we faced?
Yeah, no. The way the team played, the way the team handled playing on the road. the way the team's playing this year compared to last year, and just in the Champions League qualifiers. I think last year I was a little bit more worried about the qualifiers than I was this year. So,
yeah,
okay. And the league was weak both years. But, in fact, the league was weak for the last, or the league's been weak for years. Anyway, it just is. Yet the players are improving. So if it was all about who you're playing in the league, my question to you is, then why are the players still improving at Celtic? Because they shouldn't be. Right? If you look at Gordon Parks's, the way he's looking at it, that doesn't make any sense. The players shouldn't be improving at all because the league sucks, according to him, which that league includes his shitful fucking team from the west side of Glasgow. Anyway, so here's the reason why he's wrong, and here's the reason why all you English fuckers that talk about your EPL, your over-fucking-priced, overhyped bullshit fucking league, here's the reason why they are all fucking wrong, and why this is the true definition of the Brendan effect. It really, really is. And this is the reason why Patty understands this, and I'm glad I was wrong about Dembele and him leaving and everything. I'm glad, and all the stuff that we've heard from people who know, who have met people in Glasgow and talk about, what Dembele's looking for. Here's the reason why the Brendan effect is real. These players are improving because they're playing with Brendan. And the squad is tough. It's tough to get in that squad. So if you look at how you improve or when you improve, and I'm just going to say this from a simple view of looking at watching my son play, watching him go ahead and improving, move up the ranks, getting into where he's playing it, at a regional level in the U.S., where he's at. I know for a fact the boy does not improve while playing games. The fact the league is weak means absolutely fucking nothing. You don't improve in games. In fact, the reason why I say that is because the coaches that I've always seen play, always seen in while the kids watching the kids play, they don't coach during games. You get better when your coach tells you how to do this. This takes place in training. It doesn't take place. People don't improve in games. Now, can you measure someone's improvement in games? Yes. So let's do that. We already did. We talked about the difference between the way the team is qualified. Most of these players are basically the same. The difference between when Ronnie did it versus when Brendan did it. You look at the difference between the qualification process. You take Molde versus what happened with Astana. I'll tell you what, I'll take this team any day of the week. And I don't just mean, well, Sinclair's different or any of that other stuff. I just mean, look at how the players that are the same played. That's not because of who they played in the league. It's because of who they train against every fucking day. And if you don't understand, if Gordon Parks, he doesn't understand that you don't get better in games, you get better in training. Yeah, it would suck if he was if he went to Hamilton, that would make sense. But Patty, on the right wing, who does he train against every day? Rev, who do you think he trains against every day? You think he trains against other right wingers? No.
He trains against Sinclair.
No, he Scott trains Brown. against, he trains against the left back.
Oh, left back? Okay.
Yeah, as a right winger, you train against team's left back. Yeah. Who do you think the left back is that he trains against every day?
Brian Tierney.
Yeah. So he trains against Kieran Tierney. So if Kieran Tierney is going to be the next greatest thing and he's playing at an international level and he gets to train against an international player every day, and then you have Brendan, who is the ultimate man manager at this point in time that we're seeing, how could you say he's not going to improve? They all have improved. And it isn't because of the fucking league. It's because of who they train against every day. And when I see that, oh, your league sucks. Fuck off. It has nothing to do with the league. If you don't think this team is better than it was last year, you're crazy. You're absolutely crazy. Look at how they managed that game away in the second round of the Champions League qualifiers, or the third round. Mm-hmm. No. What did Gordon have to do in that game? Nothing.
Yeah.
They won that game 1-0 away in a game in which 2 years ago they would have fucking got their ass handed to them. Now they go to Astana and they lose 4-3, and they, you know, it could have been a lot worse, but you're playing with, you know, a 19-year-old kid and a midfielder at center half.
Right.
And he still maneuvered that boat around the iceberg. He was better than the captain of the Titanic. He was. And that's the reason why these kids are coming here. Encham came here. Oddzone came here. They didn't come here to play in the league. And they may have come here a little bit to go ahead and play in the Champions League to get in the shop window. That's part of it. Yes, I agree.
Right.
The biggest component of it is the train. Yes.
They came out and said it's like, I heard Brendan Rodgers is great with youngsters.
Yes.
So,
yes.
For youngsters especially, at least.
Yes, and I don't know how hard it is for people to fucking get that.
Well, they don't want to have to admit it, because admitting it means, you know, admitting that they are fucked.
It's just ridiculous. It drives me crazy. Because the more the more you look at it, the more you listen to it, the more you're just like, dude, shut up. I get it. You don't want Celtic to do what they're doing. That's totally fine. I get it. Just come out and say it. Well, I don't want Patty here. And I'm going to say it's lack of ambition, but I'm really afraid because they're going to fucking pound my team 5-1 again.
I was going to say, it's funny we're having this conversation on the anniversary of the first 5-1.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Again. Fuck that. I just... And it's one of those things that you're just like, come on, man. Really? Stop it. It's about who they train against. It's about how they train every day. It's about the team they've assembled in training against the people they train against. That's where you improve. You do not improve in games. No one, you may show how much you improved,
yeah,
but you're not training and getting better in games. Coaches don't coach in games. They manage. They manage players to be able to get a result. They do not coach. They don't stop the game and go, oh, no, Patty, next time do it left foot, right foot, and then do this. That's not how it works. They manage the team to be able to get through the minefield that is the game itself. They coach during the week. People improve during the week. And if you don't fucking understand that, you don't deserve to be writing for a fucking newspaper. I'm sorry. You don't.
Because that's when they say, all right, now you take what you've learned or what we've worked on Monday to Friday and put it all together on Saturday and go out there and do it.
Right. Right. And if you don't, then I take you back in, I show you video, and you train on that again. Exactly. It is not about the game. It's not about the game. Now, if you want to go ahead and say, well, Sinclair's stats are padded because he plays in the SPFL, then yes. Okay, fine. Yes. But if his stats are better this year than they were last year, what does that tell you? That he's worse or is he better? You see what I mean? That's the reason why, you know, it just drove me crazy. So anyway, so Pat, I'm glad Patty's here, and some of his touches leading into Hamilton, but oh my God, some of his touches were fucking amazing.
Oh yeah.
Oh my God. I love a couple of those touches that he had when the ball's coming down and he just like flicked it and then ran a loop around the guy. And the one touch with Oddzone, is it Oddzone? Is that what you say? Oddzone?
I'd say Eddie.
Eddie Edouard. I mean that give and go for the goal.
Mm.
Not bad. Not bad. Hit it well first time. Keeper had a little paper wrist action there. Went through.
Did you see the post game with him and Brown?
With Patty, yeah. Yeah, that was good.
And they're just like, oh, what's it like, you know, with to have him back and stuff? And he's just like, oh, yeah, you know, after, you know, he had his wee holiday. And he was just like, motherfucker.
You were off running around, sunning yourself in the United States. Meanwhile, we're here in crappy Glasgow running around or somewhere in fucking Austria or whatever. Yeah, it was good. The The goals were good. The goals were good. I'm glad Armstrong got to play. Once again, proving my point that we'll get to our lineups for later, but once again, proved my point that they rested Encham to play Tuesday and Armstrong won't see. I'm telling you, he is this year's Armstrong is last year's Lee Griffiths, and it's going to take a lot to get him back. And I think he slow played his hand beyond the value of his hand. He's fucked himself. He's going to find it really, really hard to get back in the squad. But anyway, in Sinclair,
let me ask you this real quick.
Go ahead.
Do you believe what Brendan was saying when he said that his play and his quality of play was being affected by the whole
100%?
Because it seems like he's playing back to where he was now, but because he had dropped off and, you know, when Sam stepped up and it's like, look at this guy.
Yeah. Of course. And if Encham is playing that point and Brendan, you know, trusts him, you keep him there. You give Armstrong some time, but yeah, I agree. And it does happen. It does. All I can do is I've never been in that position. You know what I mean? I don't know if you ever have to be in a position where someone rates you that highly that you're looking at a new job. Therefore, your mind's on something else. I mean, maybe like I had a girlfriend once and a hotter chick wanted me, and I was like having sex with one and thinking of the other. I don't know. But I will say this: I've watched my son play. Right, we're at a college recruiting weekend, and in the United States, Division III is like no scholarships, and Division I is like where the teams play for national championship stuff like that. He goes to a D3, a Division III identification camp, and the coach at the end of the weekend basically looked at him and said, "Well, Max, it was nice meeting you. Have a great day. You won't be back unless you want to come here for the academics." And Max is like, why not? He goes, because the coach from William & Mary, which, you know, whatever, or whatever the school is, Bob Jones or whatever the hell it was, I forget, whatever it is, William and whatever, you know, would like to talk to you. There's a D1 school. And all of a sudden now his eyes are just like, oh, I don't know if I really want to go D3 anymore, because if a D1 school really wants me. And that's just a kid talking about colleges.
Right.
You know what I mean? Now all of a sudden his whole entire idea has changed about where he wants to play. Mm-hmm. It's just really weird. It's like, oh, well, you know, the coach over at this school thinks I'm really, really good and thinks I could play D1. Then why am I wasting time looking at D3 schools? I'm like, because school is for school.
Right.
But, you know, that's just me and him. But that's the same conversation here. You know, I mean, his whole outlook changed when someone said, you know, I think you'd be really good at a higher level. And I'd love to go ahead and take you. And I think that's probably what happened with – you know, with Stewart, it's like, oh, maybe I can go. Maybe I can, and I can get this kind of money, and I can do this. And all of a sudden, to continue to get better and put your mind into things, you've got to be focused. And I honestly believe that. I don't think he was. I don't think he was.
What's that?
I don't think he was.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that's exactly what happened. And I think this is now, you know, time for him to learn and see what story is, and figure it out.
It's just weird because that's usually like a manager, such like a bullshit line, you know what I mean? But it actually seems like that was the case here.
Yeah.
You know?
I agree. I agree 100%. It really was. But I'm glad he got his goal. And I'm glad he got his goal for Scotland. You know, I'm glad for him. I'm glad he came back and wasn't hurt. You know, that stuff's really cool. But I'm more excited to see Sinclair and his conversion. His finishing conversion. I'm glad to see him in his. We'll put it down to the. We'll use the term composure in front of the goal, which I think is really, really, really good. There was a lot of movement around him. His finish across the line and going in, it was really, really good. I was happy to see he score twice. Had maybe a chance and a half to get a hat trick here or there, but really, 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 really good goals for him. And then Edward. Had his goal, excellent stuff. But I think the biggest there's two big talking points out of that game. The first one is, what was the story with Bruni? Did he kick someone in the face? Did he stomp on somebody? Is it bullshit, or is it just the Huns trying to go ahead and see if they can't get him reviewed and out of playing against them in a couple weeks.
I think it's bullshit. I didn't go back and even watch it again, but I saw it in real time. You know, with Bruni, a lot of times he tries to do the quick little, I don't know what you want to call it, kind of like antagonistic attacks, you know, sometimes that see what he can get away with, and more times than not, he doesn't get away with them. But I think that didn't really look like there was anything in it, and with Bruni, it tends to be more late in the game and shit like that anyway.
Just when you think he's growing up, and then he does it. I guess I don't know.
I don't know. It just didn't. The feeling behind it, it just didn't feel like there was anything there. But at the same time, he kind of seems like the kind of guy where, even if it was by accident, like internally, he might be like, "Oh shit," but he kind of has to keep his persona, if you will. So he'd be like, "Yeah, what? I did that. Fuck you." You know, just to kind of to keep that I don't say facade, but you know, just to keep that face, that persona. So he's definitely lucky for sure to not get a red card, because we've seen it given for less, absolutely.
And we've seen and that being said, we've seen stupid stuff that deserved a red card, not also. So yeah. It's hard to be able to feel any type of. What would be a good term here? Any type of consistency? Because I know it's hard. It is really, really hard to use the word consistency when describing anything going on with the SFA or the SPFL.
Yeah, so
we'll just use that
if it's, you know,
as a basis.
If it's something that's against us or for us, I'm not surprised in either way, because I've seen stuff go for us and against us so many times that. I'll just take what I can get.
But it was an ass whipping though, until you know the last goal at the end, which, you know, whatever. I think there's a concentration.